بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على دربه بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we send our peace and blessings among our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, there is a city in this world, a great city by the name of Taiba, that still exists today. And it was established in the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This city, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, is the city in which the Prophet of Allah, he migrated after 13 years of hardship and torture in Mecca. He migrated to this city. It was this city, my brothers and sisters in Islam, in which the Muslims established the very first Islamic state, the very first Islamic city. It was this city, my brothers in Islam, in which the Muslims expanded and they conquered and the da'wah spread. It was from this city, my brothers in Islam, the Muslims, they saw the four corners of the world. It was this city, my brothers in Islam, in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was buried. And next to him, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And next to him, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. My brothers in Islam, this is the city of the Prophet. Al-Madina, as we know, as we call it today. Now, the name Taiba, it was given that name by the Prophet of Allah. It had a previous name. That previous name was Yathrib. Now that name in Arabic has a negative connotation, and it may mean something that's a bit negative. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had a habit in changing names, people's names as well. If their name was like a disgusting name, or something that was not like it wasn't praised, something not nice, he would change their name to something better. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he migrated to Al-Madina or Taiba, he changed it from Yathrib to Taiba. And Yathrib, as it's mentioned in the Quran, it comes in a form where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he speaks on the tongue of Yusuf alayhi salam when he speaks to his brothers. When his brothers have wronged him and he wants to forgive them, he says, قَالَ لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمِ. So this is Yusuf alayhi salam speaking to his brothers, and he's saying to them that there is no wrongdoing on you guys today, and I have forgiven you. So the word Yathrib, or it comes from Tathrib, or anything like that, it means wrongdoing or sins or something like that. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he changed that to Taiba. As it's mentioned also in the Prophet's hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Umirtu bi qaryatin ta'kulu al-qura yaquluna Yathrib wa hiya al-Madina." And this is the narrator clarifying to us that Yathrib is al-Madina. "Tanfi al-nas kama yanfi al-kiru khabath al-hadid." So here is another hadith that mentions that this city was called Yathrib, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he changed it to Al-Madina. Now the munafiqun in that time, the munafiqun, the hypocrites, the people who supposedly entered Islam, yet their hearts were not content with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet and the commandments of Allah, they continued to call it Yathrib, because they knew the meaning behind it. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he changed it to Taiba, so we call it Taiba. Now how did Al-Madina come about? Where did Al-Madina come from? Is Al-Madina one thing and Yathrib another thing? Or is Al-Madina and Yathrib one thing together? Now for me to explain this to you, I'm going to give you an example. Now Sydney CBD, the city, if you were to say to someone, if you're having a conversation with someone, you were saying to them, I've got work today, I'm going to go down to the city. That's what you would say. Another person might say, there's fireworks tonight, I'm taking my missus to the city. Right? Another person might say, I want to go and have lunch at the city. You don't say Sydney CBD. You don't say Sydney City. But really, how many cities are there in Australia? There are a few, right? There's a city in every state. And which city are you talking about? But because you know the city that you're talking about, you say, I'm going to the city, and the person knows as well. So Al-Madina in Arabic means city, the city. Madina means city, Al-Madina means the city. So it became a habit. Like when someone would say, I'm going to Al-Madina, you know? Khalas, now you know I'm going to the city of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was Tayyiba. So this is how the name Al-Madina came about. So now any time Al-Madina is used, we are referring to the city of the Prophet of Allah, which is Tayyiba. Now Tayyiba means kind, and it also means something good. That's the meaning of Tayyiba. So something peaceful, something nice, something beautiful. The borders of Al-Madina. Now Al-Madina, or Tayyiba, has some borders. And there's a reason why I'm mentioning these borders. It's because Al-Madina is a sacred land. It's a sacred land. So what are the borders of Al-Madina? In the hadith sahih, عن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه, he says, المدينة حرم من كذا إلى كذا. So this is Anas narrating, and he's saying that Medina is sacred from this point to this point, and he points with his hands. Did he say the actual name? No. Now this hadith is sahih hadith, but he pointed at the different places, and there's narration that he pointed at some mountains. Through other ahadith, we have worked out that the borders of Al-Madina is between Jabal Ayr and Jabal Thawr. So there's a mountain, it's called Ayr, and there's another mountain called Thawr. And between those two is the borders of Medina. Now the reason why I mentioned, like I said, is because the Medina itself is sacred. Now, if we were to continue the hadith of Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, المدينة حرم من كذا إلى كذا لا يقطع شجرها ولا يحدث فيها حدث من أحدث حدثا فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. Now this is a very severe warning about this sacred land. You see, it's not just sacred by name, by title. No, there's a meaning behind it. There's a reason why it's sacred. There are a few things that you cannot do in a sacred land. And number one, لا يقطع شجرها, that you will not cut any tree of it. Nothing. You are not allowed to cut a tree inside this sacred land. Another one, ولا يحدث فيها حدث, and no sin or evil would ever occur in this land. And if it was to occur, it's mentioned in the hadith, من أحدث فيها حدثا أو من أحدث حدثا فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. And whoever starts a wrongdoing or an evil doing, then for him is the anger and the wrath of Allah Azza wa Jal. Not only that, the anger and the wrath of the Malaika, and the anger and the wrath of the people. This is the status of the Medina, of Al-Madina, Tayyiba, the city of the Prophet of Allah. In another hadith mentioned by Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, when a person asked him, you know, hadithna, he says to him, narrate to us something. So he says to him, مَا عِنْدَنَا شَيْءٌ إِلَّا كِتَابَ اللَّهِ. We don't have anything except for the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the Qur'an. Then he says to him, وَهَذِهِ الصَّحِيفَةِ, and this scroll. And on this scroll he had written a hadith of the Prophet of Allah. And he says, أَلْمَدِينَةُ حَرَمٌ بَيْنَ عَائِرٍ إِلَى كَذَا. So he, from this hadith, he says, Al-Madina, its borders are from عَائِر, which is the mountain of Ayr, ila kada, which is another point, and he doesn't mention here. And then he says, and this is the part that I wanted to get to, man ahdatha fiha hadathan, whoever starts an evil doing inside it, and here's the next part, which was extra from the hadith that we mentioned before, أو آوى محدثاً, or he helped someone do something wrong, or do something evil, or do a sinful act, فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. Then for him is the anger and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the angels and all of the people. Add to it, لا يقبل منه صرف ولا عدل. And for him, his salat, his fard salat, will not be accepted, and not even his sunnah salat. This is for the person who commits a sin, or he even helps someone to commit a sin, or start a sin, or any form of evil inside the city of the Prophet, Madinat Rasulillah Tayyibah, the city of the Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he migrated from Mecca to Medina, we know the very famous story of the very first actions of the Prophet of Allah. Now the companions, they were waiting for the Prophet of Allah until they saw him from far, and they were so excited, they started to sing, طَالَعَ الْبَادَرُ عَلَيْنَا. And they started to sing, they were very, very joyful, very ecstatic, they were happy that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came. And then the first action that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did was what? He was on his camel, he got off, and he let the camel walk. And the camel walked, and by the order of Allah Azza wa Jal, the camel sat in the place in which the first, it was not the first, the camel sat in the place in which the masjid of the Prophet was built. This was the miracle, was when this camel walked until Allah commanded it to sit, and when it sat, they established the masjid of the Prophet of Allah. And here in the hadith of Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he mentions, قَدِمَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْمَدِينَةَ فَأَمَرَ بِبِنَاءِ الْمَسْجِدِ. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he migrated to Medina, he ordered to build the masjid, to build the mosque. فَقَالَ يَا بَنِي النَّجَّارِ ثَامِنُونِي. Now Bani Najjar was the people who owned the land in which the camel sat. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to them, يَا بَنِي النَّجَّارِ ثَامِنُونِي. He says to them, O Bani Najjar, give me a price. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is offering them. Now, Bani Najjar, it wasn't easy for them to say, to give the Prophet of Allah a price, especially after he came, and this is the Prophet of Allah. So they said to him, فَقَالُوا لَا نَطْلُبُ ثَمَنُهُ إِلَّا إِلَى اللَّهِ. We do not ask any of the money that we want, except that we want the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now from the, if you were to look at this hadith from face value, you'd understand that Bani Najjar did not take anything. But Ahlul Sirah, the people of Sirah, they have agreed that Bani Najjar did take a thaman, they did take a price for the land in which the masjid was built. Because the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not agree, he paid them something. So the hadith moves on, they say, and then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, فَأَمَرَ بِقُبُورِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ فَنُبِشَتْ. So on this land, there were some graves. And these graves had non-Muslim people inside them. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, and he ordered the companions to go and dig out the graves and to move the remains of those in the grave to another spot. So here we have a fiqh ruling in which you are allowed to move the graves of the non-Muslims from one place to another, as long as the grave is not someone who is like of high status and it does not cause fitna. And so this occurred when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Medina. And Medina, when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam he migrated to it, it wasn't very clean. There was a lot of rubbish around. Yani, it was like it was deserted. You know, when you go to a place where there's like trees falling down because no one's around. You know, like no one really cares about it. And there was also a sickness inside Medina, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove the humma. It was a type of disease that was inside Medina, to remove it from the city of the Prophet, which is Taiba. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here, he orders for the graves of the mushrikeen to be dug out and moved to another place. ثم بالخلب فسويت وبالنخل فقطع فصف النخل قبلة المسجد. So here on this land there were trees, right? And here's the exception. There were trees, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he ordered for the trees to be cut and to use the palms of those trees and the leaves of those trees to build the masjid. So even though it's a sacred land, if there is a reason for you to cut the trees or the palm trees or the leaves or whatever it is, you have the right to do so. However, if you were walking in Medina and you saw a stalk, right, and you thought, you know what, I want to break it. No, you're not allowed to break it, because this is a sacred land, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he forbade us from ripping any stalks or any trees or any form of plants. So this was the state in which the masjid of the Prophet of Allah was built. So it was built in Medina, and this is how it occurred. Now, Al-Madina, Tayba, has a very high status in Islam. An extremely high status. And in a hadith narrated by Abi Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أُمِرْتُ بِقَرْيَةٍ تَأْكُلُ الْقُرَىٰ يَقُولُونَ يَثْرِبْ وَهِيَ الْمَدِينَةِ تَنْفِي النَّاسِ كَمَا يَنْفِي الْكِيرُ خَبَثَ الْحَدِيدِ. Now this is a very amazing hadith. And when I first read this hadith and my sheikh explained this to me, wallahi, I was just amazed by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does for this city. You know, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, I was ordered to migrate to a city in which this city eats other cities in the form that it expands from here. So Islam expanded from where? From Al-Madinah, from Taiba. So he ate other cities in the form that Islam expanded that way. And it was called Yathrib, right? Back to the naming. وَهِيَ الْمَدِينَةِ. This is the Medina of the Prophet of Allah. تَنْفِي النَّاسِ. And here's the part which amazed me so much. تَنْفِي النَّاسِ كَمَا يَنْفِي الْكِيرُ خَبَثَ الْحَدِيدِ. That this city, it rids people, it exiles people. Now I want you to imagine this. You've got a furnace and you've got some metal. Now sometimes if you were to dig out some metal from the earth, there will be some rocks and some dirt inside it. So the way that you clean this metal is that you heat it up to a high temperature, so much so that the metal becomes liquid and it separates from all the impurities on that rock. So everything that came with the metal falls. So the liquid moves and everything else falls, and it moves away to another section. So now you've got pure metal. Now, here's the example in which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uses. He says that the Medina, the Prophet of the city of the Prophet of Allah, it exiles and it rids people as the metal separates from everything that's impure in that rock. Why? Here's the even more amazing part. Which people? Now if you were to think about it, is this the Medina that we know of? That it exiles people? You know, is this the city of the Prophet? It rids people away? No, which type of people? You see, the people who try to do a sin, or who have something in their heart that they're not content with Allah and His Prophet, that they try to establish something evil in the city of the Prophet, this city will get rid of them. How? If you have a look inside the city of the Prophet, and if any of you have ever been, you will realize there is no room for fasad no room for haram, no room for sin, nothing to displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just peaceful. Its tranquility is unparalleled. It's a place where no sin can occur. Why? Because a person who wants to perform a sin, he comes into the city and he sees everyone in the masjid, and he sees everyone reading Quran, and he sees everyone on his doing tasbih. He thinks, "Man, I haven't got a place, I haven't got a spot for this place. I can't stay here. I can't commit a sin here. No one will ever help me." You know? So he leaves and he commits a sin somewhere else. Maybe he goes to New York or something. Right? But not in the city of the Prophet. Not in the city of the Prophet. تَنْفِي النَّاسِ كَمَا يَنْفِي الْكِيرُ خَبَثَ الْحَدِيدِ عن سفيان بن زهير أنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول تفتح اليمن فيأتي قوم يبسون فيتحملون بأهلهم ومن أطاعهم والمدينة خير لهم لو كانوا يعلمون. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, in the future, Yemen will open up. And the people in Medina, they will gather their stock, and they will start herding their animals, and they will gather their family, with the intention to go to where? To Yemen. They want to go to Yemen because Yemen opened up, and Yemen was, had a place the standards of living there was not like in Medina. So the dunya life in Yemen was much more extravagant than what it was in Medina. So people, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says this, people will gather, they will grab their stocks, they will grab their families, and they will go to where? Towards Al-Yaman. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says after, وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. But Al-Madina, the city of the Prophet, is better for them only if they knew. Only if they knew. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he then says, وَتُفْتَحُ الشَّارِ فَيَأْتِي قَوْمٌ يَبُسُّونَ فَيَتَحَمَّلُونَ بِأَهْلِهِمْ وَمَنْ أَطَاعَهُمْ وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ وَتُفْتَحُ الْعِرَاقُ فَيَأْتِي قَوْمٌ يَبُسُّونَ فَيَتَحَمَّلُونَ بِأَهْلِهِمْ وَمَنْ أَطَاعَهُمْ وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he then moves on and he says, Al-Sham will open up. And we know Al-Sham, which is Syria, Palestine, Jordan, all of those countries with it, Lebanon, it will open up. Yani the Muslims will conquer it. And so people will gather their stock, and they'll grab their families, and they'll go where? In the direction of Al-Sham. وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. Medina, the city of the Prophet, is better for them only if they know. Only if they knew. And then Iraq will open up. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Iraq will open up. And the Muslims will conquer Iraq. And then there will be a group of people that will gather their stocks and gather their family. And they will go heading towards Al-Iraq. وَالْمَدِينَةُ خَيْرٌ لَهُمْ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. But Medina was better for them only if they know. Only if they know. Why is Al-Madina better? Why? Is it because of the dunya purposes? No. Because of the barakah that Medina has. You know, one salah in Medina is worth 1,000 prayers of yours today. You know, you pray your dhuhr today 1,000 times before you reach one person praying one dhuhr prayer in Medina. This is the barakah that's enlightened the city of the Prophet. Al-Madina, Taiba, this is the city of the Prophet. عن أنس عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, and he's a very beautiful hadith in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has answered. The Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, he makes a dua, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has answered this dua. The Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says on the authority of Anas, he narrates, the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said, اللهم اجعل بالمدينة ضعفي ما جعلت بمكة من البركة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he makes a dua and asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, give the Medina, give Al-Madina twice the barakah that's existent in Mecca. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, make the barakah that you've applied in Medina double the barakah in Mecca. In what sense? The ulama, when they were doing sharh on this hadith, when they were doing analysis on this hadith, when they were explaining it, here the barakah is in terms of the dunya. Now, when, if any of you have ever visited Mecca and Medina, or if you've ever heard someone who says, Wallah, I went to Hajj this year, majority of the time, the person will tell you, I love Medina more than Mecca. Even though Mecca has the Kaaba, in which all of us face, so we can pray toward that area, yet a lot of people find something in their heart for Medina over Mecca. And this is the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's double the barakah. You see, when you go to Hajj and you experience the tawaf and you experience the life in Mecca, you feel like it's a very harsh and something very great is happening in the city. You know, sometimes it trembles your heart so much so that you get scared. You get scared in the city, in Mecca. Yet when you go to Medina, you just find tranquility, and peace, and ease of mind, and ease of heart, and you find that a place, you just can't describe it. You know, I've spoken to so many people that have been to Hajj, and I was speaking to my mother-in-law a few weeks ago, and she says to me, I can't describe it. Now, she went years and years ago, and she was telling me when I came back, everyone was asking me, how was your Hajj trip? And I'll tell them what this, we did this, we did that. And when I reached the point of Medina, she'll start bawling her eyes.
In Mecca, I experienced Wahsha. In Medina, I experienced, I was in a Waha. You know what is Waha like?
Kif yani Waha? You know that?
Wahsha, yani.
Wahsha, Arif Wahsha. Amma al Medina?
Waha, like paradise or a garden.
MashaAllah. So here we go. We've got another testimonial. One of the brothers here, he went to Mecca. In Mecca, you know, he's saying that when I went to Mecca, I felt wahsha, like this strong feeling, you know, this very like harsh feeling. But when I went to Medina, he's saying I felt like it was a paradise. You know, I felt like it was a garden. This is the city of the Prophet, Al-Madina, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam. عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما بين بيتي ومنبري روضة من رياض الجنة ومنبري على الحوض أو منبري على حوضي. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, going back to the status of the Medina and to what level it has, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, between my house and my pulpit, my minbar, and minbar is this one here behind me, if you have a look, this is a minbar. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he had a minbar. So he says, between my house and the minbar is a garden of paradise. This is a section of paradise. So this is why whenever you go to Medina, you find there's a big congestion. Where? In this little spot here. Why? Because people want to pray two rak'at. Because if you pray two rak'at there, it's as if you have prayed two rak'at in Jannah. This is the city of the Prophet of Allah in Medina. Now the end of times, when the time of this universe is going to come to an end, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will all experience the death and what comes after it, and then the judgment, the city of the Rasul Al-Madina, through these times of hardship and fitan, it is protected. It is protected. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال إن الإيمان لا يأرز إلى المدينة كما تأرز الحية إلى جحرها. Now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that iman, belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right, this is your core, your aqidah, your core of Islam, the foundations of your Islam, al-iman, in which al-Madinah was the center point, and everything expanded after that from where? From Medina. In those times, in the end of times, that type of iman will come back. Yani it will leave Australia, it will leave America, it will leave Canada, it will leave Mexico, it will leave everywhere else, it will leave the Arab countries, it will leave Syria, it will come back where? To Medina. Just like, and he gives us an example, when a snake leaves its hole and then it comes back, you see that its head goes in, and then everything follows, and then it gets comfortable in this little hole. So the iman, it went, and then it will come back, and it will be protected. Where? In Medina. This is the place. In Medina, it will be protected there. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions in another hadith on the authority of Abi Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أنه سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول تتركون المدينة على خير ما كانت لا يغشاها إلا العواف. That you will leave Medina, people will leave Medina until nothing will exist inside Medina except animals that have like a claw. And these animals are like the hawks and the falcons, animals like that, right? It's a desert. There's no one there. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, you will leave it. There will be nothing left except for those animals. And then he's speaking of the end of times, that is. وَآخِرُ مَنْ يُحْشَرُ, and the last of people that will die, رَعِيَان, two farmers, مِنْ مُزَيْنَةَ, and he, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he pinpoints, they are from a tribe called Muzaynah. يُرِيدَانِ الْمَدِينَةَ, they want to go to where? Al-Madinah. That's the destination. So they go and they head out. يَنْحِطَانِ بِغَنَمِهِمَا, they do the sounds in which a farmer does so he can get his animals to move. And they move towards that city. فَيَجِدَانَهَا وَحْشًا, and they will find it deserted. They will find it a place that you cannot live in. حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَا ثَنِيَّةَ الْوَدَاعَ, until they reach the point. Now, okay. Thaniyat al-Wada' is a place in which the Arabs had, it was like an elevated area in which the musafir, the person who travels, would go to this spot, and his family would follow him until this spot, and then he will walk off. And then the family would come back. Until they reach this spot, that is an elevated area, حتى إذا بلغ ثنية الوداع خرّا على وجوههما. Over here, they will die. And these are the last two that will die, as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions in this hadith. Now, speaking of the protection of Al-Madinah in those tough times, in the times of tribulations in particular, when Al-Dajjal will come out, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions in a hadith narrated by Anas, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ليس من بلد إلا سيطأه الدجال. There is not a country in which the Dajjal will not touch. يعني the Dajjal will go to every single country and every single city, and he will go and do the destruction, and he will do the fitan, and he will go and do and do and do, except إِلَّا مَكَّةَ وَالْمَدِينَةَ, except Mecca and Medina. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he then says, لَيْسَ مِنْ نِقَابِهَا نَقَبٌ إِلَّا عَلَيْهِ الْمَلَائِكَةَ صَافِينَ يَحْرُسُونَهَا. That there is not a border or a checkpoint on the borders of Medina and Mecca except there are angels standing firm and strong, protecting Mecca and Medina. There's angels protecting these cities. And this is the city of the Prophet of Allah. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in those times, he will mention that when the Dajjal, his fitna will come out, he will not be able to enter. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, in the city of Medina, ثم ترجف المدينة بأهلها أو ثم ترجف المدينة بأهلها ثلاث رجفات. That in Medina, there will be like an earthquake three times inside the Medina, and it will scare its people. فيخرج الله كل كافر ومنافق. That if, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from that zilzal, from that earthquake, He will remove all the kuffar and all of the munafiqeen, and they will run away from Medina. So this is what happens in the end of times. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions in another hadith, in particular what Ad-Dajjal will do when he will try to come to Medina. It's narrated by Abi Sa'id al-Khudri. قال حدثنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حديثا طويلا عن الدجال. He says that the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, he gave us a very long hadith about Dajjal, and he says a few words. فكان فيما حدثنا به, he says there are a few things that he said amongst it. أنه قال يأتي الدجال, the Dajjal will come, وهو محرم عليه أن يدخل نقاب المدينة, and it is haram for him to enter past the borders of Al-Madinah, right? فَيَنْزِلُ بَعْضُ الصَّبَّاخِ الَّتِي بِالْمَدِينَةِ فَيَخْرُجُ لَهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ رَجُلٌ هُوَ خَيْرُ النَّاسِ. So after this Dajjal, after he's been to everywhere and he's done the destruction that he can do, he comes to Al-Madinah and he realizes he can't go past its borders, so he sits outside the borders, sitting down with his people. And so a man from inside Medina will exit. A man from inside Medina will exit. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he describes him, he says he's from the best of people. So this person, he walks out. He goes to Ad-Dajjal. And he says to him, أشهد أنك الدجال. I bear witness that you are the Dajjal. الَّذِي حَدَّثَنَا عَنْكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. In which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us about you. Very strong words. فَيَقُولُ الدَّجَّالُ. And then the Dajjal will reply to him. And speaking to his own people, أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِن قَتَلْتُ هَذَا ثُمَّ أَحْيَيْتَهُمْ هَلْ تَشُكُونَ فِي الْأَمْرِ. He says to the people, do you think if I kill this man right now and then I bring him back to life, would you ever have some sort of doubt in me? Speaking to his people. فَيَقُولُونَ لَا. No. Reply, no, of course we won't have any doubt in you. So he kills him. He kills this man. In a narration, it is mentioned that he is chopped in half. One side of his body will be on this side, and the other side will be on this side. Now what happens? The Dajjal would walk in between those two parts, and the man will come together, back to life. فَيَقُولُ حِينَ يُحْيِيهِ. And this is the Dajjal. عَفْوًا. This is the man, after he comes back to life, after he comes back to life, after he died and he came back to life, he says to the Dajjal, فيقول, والله, by Allah, he makes an oath, ما كنت قط أشد بصيرة مني اليوم. فيقول الدجال, أقتله, فلا يصلت عليه. This man, he gets up and he says, والله, I am now 110% sure that you are the Dajjal. Why? Because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he informed us that you will kill me and then you'll bring me back to life. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he also informed us that you will not be able to kill me again. So he says to his people, kill him, kill him, kill him. And won't be able to. This is the end of times. And this is the status of Al-Madinah, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you a trip to the city of the Prophet of Allah, so you can experience a fraction of what I just said. You won't even anything I just said won't even be a fraction of what you will experience in Al-Madinah. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the opportunity to go, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me the opportunity to go as well. Say ameen. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.